the original Gaelic Harp, the Clarsach, the wire strung instrument, predominantly. That's what he's most interested in, and so, yeah, I should let him talk about it rather than myself.
Okay, sorry, Mark.
Okay, what we're going to talk about today, I think I should tell you about the harp in Scottish music, and that's kind of an enormous subject. It's kind of difficult to get everything in and kind of feel it away. So we're just going to kind of scoot through basics, I guess. And if you actually have any questions, please shout out, because I'm going to be quite informal in how we're doing this. So the first thing that you have to deal with if you're interested in the harp in Scottish music is that most of the time you still actually anything to do with music at all. There's this whole bunch of kind of national, mythical, romantic, fantasy image making. You know, the harp isn't an icon and there's a symbol. And that's what I use in my cover picture. This chap in the 1930s is a poet and a sort of Scottish, a very Scottish Gaelic poet he wants to be, and an aristocrat who isn't a big aristocrat. So this is the frontispiece portrait of him in his book of poetry. As you can see, he's got everything. He's got a big house, he's got the mansion, he's got the piper, he's got an ancient manuscript, and he's got writing, and he has a harp there. And this is not a working harp. I mean, this harp is in the West Highland Museum in Port William now. It's not actually a functioning musical instrument. It's just a kind of sideboard. But I think that's very interesting, the way that he has it there. And you can still power it. It's one of his icons of being a Scottish poet. So this is a thing that you have to think about all the time in the background, is how does this relate to actually producing music as a musical art form? And they often fight with each other.
Okay. So the second thing you have to deal with, when you're talking about the harp traditions in Scotland, is that it's a very artificial thing to talk about the harp traditions in Scotland, because for almost all of the history of that harps have been played in Scotland, it's been part of a wider cultural world. And so that's what this map is going to show you. So the harp tradition, the harp is never a folk instrument, it's never a local, small-scale thing in the way that song traditions are, or even fiddle. The harp traditions were always a high-status, learned tradition. And this meant that the harpists were travelling a lot. So to learn to play the harp, you'd have to go away and be apprenticed to a master, and you would tour around, you would seek employment by being a high-status musician in a house of a great lord, and you would move from one to another, you know? So a lot of the harpists were trained in Ireland and worked in Scotland, or the other way around, and it seems to me to have been a big international scene. International, but you know, I struggle with this idea of what are we counting as a nation, because the national boundaries are very modern things. And I'm talking at least about 1,000 years, maybe. So I have this idea of the old Gaelic world, and you can see basically the left hand side of this map gives you this kind of cultural unit, and the boundary, the edge of it, has shifted over time. So, way back in medieval times, we were probably on the edge of it. Whereas now, the boundary is shifted right back, you just skip the edges of the islands and the Western Islands. So this is another thing to think about, that we're always looking for these connections. And that gets important when we're looking at areas that are based on evidence, because sometimes you have to piece fragments of evidence together from all over this period world to try and understand what the future is. You can't be narrow and nationalistic and focus on what's happening in Scotland and ignore everything else. So everyone likes to start at the beginning. So these are the oldest, these are some of the oldest harp objects that we have. People call them Pictish stones because they're associated with cultures that are Picts. They don't have any of those funny Pictish symbols on. So I think even slightly later than the very classical Pictish symbols. You get these high crosses, basically, installed in the churchyard, and they have, I think they have Old Testament scenes on them. So you see the left-hand one, you've got these figures, and it's not entirely clear who they are.
represent both of these figures as sort of icons of King David. And King David's main attribute is that he plays a stringed instrument. And so when these stones are built, suddenly each stringed instrument starts to be a blob shape and starts to be a triangular shape. So people latch onto this, ah, you know, it's a harp. And there's not much you can tell from a technical musical point of view about these instruments, because they're just fuzzy triangles and stripes on the middle. They can get very excited about the Pictish harp, and there are companies nowadays who make a good living making reconstructed Pictish harps and playing Pictish music on them, but this is all you have, is this fuzzy triangle with stripes on. And you can even go the other way and say, well, you know, where are these images coming from? But the stone carver who made these two stones in this part of Scotland, where are they getting their ideas from? Have they got a musician in front of them playing music that they're copying? Or have they got a Byzantine carpet imported from Eastern Europe in the picture of King David that they're just copying? So there's all these questions. So once again, we're back in the world of the symbol, the icon. In this case, it's the icon of King David. But it doesn't tell us anything about actual music. Okay, as time goes on, the images get less fuzzy, and you can start saying more technical things about it. So this one's an interesting one. So this is the Iona Psalter, and this is the Psalter, the Book of Psalms, that belongs to Prioress Beatrice on Iona. She's the daughter of Somerled, the Lord of the Isles. So this is a high-status West Highland cultured lady, and then on the first page of the psalm, here's a picture. And so does this tell us anything about the kind of heart? And the answer is obviously no, it doesn't. Because I think the book was probably made in the south of England, and the artist who drew it is copying other books. So, you know, this is a shape of harp that you see a lot in European and English manuscripts. And some people take this seriously, and some people use a blueprint to make a harp and talk about how it's tuned. Symbolism, and again, it's King David. You know, so this idea of King David as the person of the heart is very important, very strong, and it can trip us up if we try and take it literally. Okay, so this is a 17th century ceiling in Edinburgh, and it's painted, and people get very excited by this picture because they look at this, the harp on this picture, and this is a type of harp that's very common on the continent. It's, you can see it's very tall and thin and pointed. People call it a Gothic harp, funky shape. There are instruments of this type in museums, and so you can start getting ready to think about, well, were they playing them in Scotland? Is this one different to the ones in museums? Or can you tell us about how Scottish musicians took this continental harp and used it in a different way? We still have the same one, they're still King David. Okay, so it's still an icon, it's not necessarily showing us what kind of harp would have been heard in the room underneath that ceiling in Edinburgh in 1720. But it's all interesting. There's things you can say about this, but you always have to filter it through this understanding of the nature of the symbolism. Okay, this one's very interesting. This is one of the earliest West Highland images of a harp. And unlike Prioress Beatrice's Psalter, this was actually made in West Highland, so it's not a foreign import. Okay, and it's not King David either. I'm not sure who it is. There is an inscription above on the blank panel at the top of the stone telling us whose gravestone this was, just to work away. You can't really know. The images on these gravestones are all mostly secular images, and they're to do with aristocratic status that you're hunting the scene. So here you have a man riding a horse who's either a hunter or a warrior knight, and he has a harper with him. And so I think that this is more to do with projecting the status of a great lord having a harper in his household. Okay. So you can start talking about social use of the instrument. But it's still very symbolic. And you'll also see it doesn't really tell us very much technical about how the instrument works and how many strings it's got and how it's tuned, because it's so fuzzy, it doesn't even have to write a triangle, just a triangle. So there's a limit to what you can say about one of the work that I'm trying to do is to line up all these images, and when you get them all lined up all together, and you start comparing between them, but it's still very difficult because you've got so many things going on. Okay, the picture completely changes in the late medieval West Highlands because suddenly there are actual instruments preserved and complete. Okay, and this is a completely different deal from all the things that we've been looking at so far, because this is an actual working musical instrument. This is not a symbol. This is an actual musical instrument that a musician would have played and played music by. So having things like this totally transforms our understanding of what the old music was like. This doesn't tell us very much about the symbolism of it, but it tells us an immense amount about the musical artistic side of things. So there are two ancient harps that are preserved in the National Museum in Edinburgh. There are about 16 in museums in Ireland, so Ireland's a lot more of these old harps than we do in Scotland, but they're clearly all part of the same group. And so this is interesting. You can't study these two Edinburgh ones on their own. You're studying them as part of the combined Scottish and Irish group into the map of the old Gaelic world. There's no reason to think that this one was actually made in Scotland. It could easily be made in Ireland. The ones in Ireland could easily be made in Scotland. So don't fall into that trap of thinking that these are the two Scottish parts and the other one's called Irish. Okay, there's just so much that you can think about looking at these ancient instruments that you can't think about looking at the images. I mean, you can see that this instrument, I think it's been dropped down the spiral staircase a few times, and then repaired, and then being kept on playing. So there's things you can tell about it. There's a lot of very interesting things. Written on it. It has people's names and dates. You can scratch on it with pencils. It's got wear from the you see, above the H of parts and just below the little circular hole, you see the edges very polished and smooth. And this is where the hand of the player is rested on this version of the rubs used, making sort of sense of people actually holding the thing and playing it. This is the second one in the National Museum in Edinburgh. It's smaller, and it's quite different in the way it looks, because it's covered in decoration, and it's got a slightly different shape. But it's structurally, there's lots of comparisons, and so there's a lot you can learn about the old music tradition by comparing the different museum instruments and seeing what are the things that are similar. Okay, because the things that are similar, I think, are the design features that are common and consistent to people who are trying to play this music. They're the people who commission the instruments. And so understanding the old instruments of the group gives you a lot of insight into what the old music was and how it worked. So one of my students and colleagues has just completed her PhD at Edinburgh University, and her PhD was to study these two old instruments. Scientist back there, she's doing an archaeological study of them. So just in the last few years, there's an immense amount of new information that's coming out that we're also trying to digest and understand. So this is an example of the kind of work she's doing. So this is the harp fed through a hospital CAT scanner, and then you can slice and dice it on the computer and do all kinds of interesting things. So you can see the inside of the instrument, you can see how it's fitted together. And so there's all kinds of stuff going on in this picture. So the dark stuff is more dense, so it's things like iron nails and glass scraps. And the grey stuff is the wood, and the white stuff is the air. So you can see the wood grain, and so this instantly raises up questions about how maker is selecting the pieces of wood. Why is he choosing this wood in this direction? You can see that the three components are different shades for the different types of wood. Think of the violin tradition. There's a very strong tradition amongst instrument makers about exactly how you do things. And violinists are very fussy. If an instrument maker makes a new type of violin, slightly different from how everyone else is doing it, people won't buy it, people won't play it, it's not how it doesn't work. And I think in the same kind of way that these old art traditions, that the musicians can do exactly what they want to do, is what they want to do. And the instrument makers have to produce instruments that fit that very fussy. this is the results of the commission, and then we have to kind of reverse engineer that result to understand what are the requirements. And then and the, what are the requirements tells us what is it. It's kind of a laborious job. Do you understand? Do you see what I mean about how that works? So this, and this is just one slide, and you can do 100 different slides, and each one tells you 50 different things. Like I say, it's an insane amount of new data in the last few years. And so just to point out that I mentioned there's more than just the two Edinburgh instruments. This is the other most important instrument, and this is the one in Trinity College in Dublin. You'll all be familiar with this one because it's the one that's on the Guinness label. Okay. I mean, no, really it is, because when Guinness wanted to design the label, they went to Trinity College and they drew the harp and you know, a couple of hundred years ago. So this medieval musical instrument is the most copied, it's the most familiar ancient musical instrument in the world, I would think. This is one of the Guinness label, and this is the Irish conscience. And for me, one of the most interesting things about this is that it's almost identical to the last one that I showed you, the Harp of Scotland.
If we zoom back two spaces.
So there's all kinds of things you can look at. So look at the two-headed fish on the front, the circle, the animals in, you count the strings, it's got 29 strings, you can look at the designs on the big hollow sandbox, the circles and crosses.
There's probably 100 things I could point out on this instrument,
which are exactly the same on this one. Yeah, and that's interesting to me, that these two ancient instruments are, for all intents and purposes, identical. I mean, there's lots of subtle detail differences between them, in the way that there's subtle detail differences between two upright pianos, but they're basically the same instrument. Okay, so that's very interesting. Now, this one hasn't been studied at all. You can barely even get good photographs of it. And so the best image I've got to show you is a Gaelic postcard, which is just not good. And I think one of the reasons for that is because it's the national symbol. And therefore they get nervous if things follow from the study. Yeah. You know, we have all these questions. How can we put it in through the CAT scanner, see what's inside it? Can we take samples of it and recarbonate it and find out how old it is? What would happen if you carbon dated it kind of as a 1970 fake? And it's the national symbol of Ireland. You know, that's a difficult one. It's about the two-inch fair that we better not knowing. But from a musical point of view, of course you're better off knowing, but from a national symbolism point of view, you know, the myth, this is what I said at the beginning, the myth is more important than the music. And we run up against this all the time. So now that we have all the results from Karen Loomis' work in Edinburgh, we've got all the more questions about this thing in terms of college. They're all desperate to get an answer for education. And then there's like 15 more in other museums in Ireland that are also in the queue to find out more information about them. So there are handout sheets, and I didn't print them out because Jonathan said he'd put them on the system for you, so you should all have them. And he combined them into quiz. I don't think they were ordered them in. But there's a sheet which has lots of pictures. Have you all seen that one? Okay.
I've made mini versions of it here so you can look at.
So this is kind of like my summary sheet of what the of how I would divide up the old editions. So you can see I've divided them into three. There's the smaller instruments, like the one in Trinity College, and like the one in the museum. There's the bigger instruments, basically the same thing, but just more beefy. And then after about 1650, you have a lot of there's changes all over Europe in musical instrument design and function and in music, and all kinds of instruments get bigger and change their shape, and the Gaelic harps do the same thing. You can see some of these much taller instruments. That seems to be just an Irish phenomenon. So as far as I can see, already dying out by 1700 or so, until the harp in Scotland never really seemed to take on this new improved shape, where the harp in Ireland were much more progressive, and they perhaps followed with new ideas and with them. Okay? So we talked about this old Gaelic world. I think as time goes on, it becomes more and more split into Ireland and Scotland. So, you know, by 1650, by 1700, they were already drifting apart in a different direction. This is why the harp tradition starts to fall by that time. So in Scotland, it bumbles on in the old way and dies out by 1750. In Ireland, it takes on new ideas and manages to keep going until about 1800, late 1850, before it dies out as well. So I'm saying both in Scotland and Ireland, the harp dies out completely. There's very little happening up the state of numbers, and that's interesting as well. Because in the 19th century, that's the time when, in Ireland at least, the harp as a symbol is of this height. And again, you've got this idea of the symbol of heights in music. So does the harp die out partly because it becomes too symbolic to charge? And it becomes too musical then to play the harp because there's too much symbolic stuff going on?
I don't know.
But there's certainly this symbolic interest. And so what happens, this is the second sheet in your handout. So what happens is people are really interested in the harp from the 19th century onwards, but there's no tradition of playing it or making it. Nobody knows how to make a harp, nobody knows how to play a harp in the old tradition, but people are really interested in it. So what do? You make it up. Okay? So there are people who are desperate to hear the harp, to hear the old Irish and Scottish harp. There are people desperate to play it. No one knows how to do it. So what they do is, there are other harp traditions, of course, and I should mention this at the beginning, everywhere in the world has an independent harp tradition, and the continental harp tradition is very strong and continues right the way through. So what people do is they send off the harp makers who are working in that kind of continental tradition. They say, can you make us an old Gaelic harp? And they just make it up. And so the first person to do that was John Egan in the early 1800s in Ireland, and he was a professional maker of a big orchestral pedal harp, and so he invented a new type of little ancient Gaelic harp, and basically it was a really clever invention, because he realised that what people wanted was they wanted a continental style instrument that you could play classical music on, but that looked really ancient and cute and Irish. So he took the whole working principles of the big orchestral harp, shrunk it, and painted it green with gilded shamrock, and it was a roaring commercial success. And you can see from the from the image at the top there that the way it worked, I've got a better image of that which is coming up. Actually, while I've been talking to them, I can talk through my slides because they do the same thing. So we're thinking that early 1800s, okay, I've jumped ahead of myself here, because before even John Egan did his thing, this is a woman in Scotland, she's called Margaret MacLean Cofane. She was a ward, it's a ward for Scotland. She helped Watty with a lot of his research, but as a background, his novels and things. And she was a Gaelic speaker, a lecturer of folklore tradition, a paper musician, and they had a big orchestral pedal harp at their house in Mull. This is a portrait of a very well of her playing her orchestral harp. But she used it to play traditional old Gaelic song errors. She comes from singing Gaelic. She was interested in trying to keep the old traditions going. But she had no concept that a big orchestral pedal harp was a different type of instrument to the 18th century. So I mean, we never crossed her mind that there's an inventive snatch here to play the old Gaelic errors, obviously, and the orchestral. Is that a very modern idea? I don't think it's a modern idea. It's a kind of categorization idea that sees the big differences between the two differences. So here's John Egan that I was mentioning. So he saw there was a visual difference. Okay, he saw that the ancient harps were small and curving and cute, and that the orchestral harps are huge and classical and formal. So he, like I said, he shrunk the classical mechanism into
taught. He's a very classical, educated class lady who's learned orchestral pedal technique as a teacher, and actually considers it to play on a more of Irish melody style and Irish music on it. Mm-hmm. So this was very big in the 1830s, 1840s. It kind of disappeared after that. And nobody really explained to me why that is. I don't really understand why it went out of fashion, partly because the main socialite lady who was pushing it died. Partly because there was a recession, I think, partly because John Egan died and stopped making the instruments. But there was a kind of 50-year gap in the second half of the 19th century where there wasn't much harp action going on in Scotland or Ireland. And in the 1890s, there was a big Gaelic revival in Scotland and in Ireland, slightly separately, because by this time they become modern nations, and, you know, they're no longer part of the combined world. And so what happened in the 1890s is you have exactly the same deal. There's people who are desperate to hear the harp, people who are desperate to play the harp, and there's nobody who knows how to do it in the old tradition. There's nobody who knows how to make it. So you send off to a London orchestral little harp maker, so you can make the ancient style harp. So this gentleman on the right is he's a professional maker of orchestral pedal harps. And so he does the same kind of thing that Egan does. He makes something that works like an orchestral pedal harp, but looks really cute. And his one actually looks quite medieval. It's got a lot of visual design features taken from the medieval harp, but functionally and structurally, it's totally modern. It works just like an orchestral harp. And here's our lady on the left who won the Gaelic Scene with thousands of hundreds. Also the main way that this new instrument was disseminated was through these competitions, the festival in Ireland, the Fage, you know, all this prize for playing the Irish harp, which is basically the same kind of deal as this. And so this tradition, this kind of doubly reinvented tradition, invented by Egan in the 1820s, and then reinvented in the 1890s by harp makers in London, and elsewhere, this formed the basis of a continuing modern tradition of playing Scottish and Irish harp. These are the instruments are kind of lightweight, they're curvy, they're designed to be played with quite classical styles, they're designed to be played with chord progressions, and they have mechanisms to make semitones, so you can change key, and they have strings in the gut, like an orchestral harp, which gives you kind of this soft parlor kind of sound. But this is the kind of Celtic harp that you would probably be familiar with. This is where it comes from. And so it carries on through. And so these are some of the more interesting Scottish exponents of it. Marjorie Kennedy Fraser, the lady looming over the Tapper's shoulder. She's the song collector. She went out to Western Isles in 1900, that kind of time, collected songs, brought them back, and performed them in an art style with kind of accompaniment, and made their millions that way. And got the backs up of a lot of traditional musicians, because this is kind of music. And she thought, what piano accompaniments would they want? This kind of iconic and symbolic role. So her daughter, Patapa, learned to play the harp and got hold of one of these Irish harps. She had to get an Irish harp because there wasn't really anybody in Scotland making them, so she sent to London one of the Irish harp makers specifically ordered to be painted without shamrocks on it. It's a special order. She wants Irish harp, not Scottish harp. She's one of the things, the symbolism is so intense. And Heloise Russell Ferguson is very interesting. Her harp is an American harp that she saw when she was in America in a shop. But it's the same deal, it's an American company that was doing the same thing, making elements of Irish harp. Plays this music, very classical, very elegant. There's a 1920s groundbreaking recording of Patapa singing and playing her harp that you can look up and find online and kind of listen and you find it. But I think I forgot, I just thought that she didn't get it online. Now, the good sense of what these people are doing in the 1930s. Heloise especially is one of the most interesting people because she was young in the 30s and she did this very classical style Marjorie Kennedy Fraser song. But then in the 60s she kind of reinvented herself as an avant-garde and she makes a record of a psychedelic she's kind of neglected hero, and she's very interesting and creative.
Okay, so in the 1930s, Henry Griggs was very important in the Scottish harp scene. He was a violin maker, and so he looked at the harps, the kind of thing that Heloise and Patapa were playing. But these are really actually not very good musical instruments. You know, they're a bit clunky. People who made them didn't really know what they were doing, so he bent his violin making skills to improve the harp. And so you can see he's got a slightly different shape, a bit more angular. It's very 30s in the shape, I think, kind of quite mannerist. And his instruments, because they're such good musical instruments, they kind of took the whole revival a step further. And so Alison Kinnaird has one. She started playing in the 70s, I guess. And she still plays it today. You know, so Griggs' instruments really fit into the modern world. And there's few people who have still improved them now. So there's the last 10, 20 years who have made big step forward. So now I think Griggs' instruments make people think they were obsolete because they're such bigger, powerful instruments made now. So it's continuing to develop. So hopefully that gives you a sense, a little overview of the history of harps in Scotland from 1,000 years ago up to the 20th century. Yeah? And I hope you can see that there are two quite separate traditions that don't connect because there was a gap in between them. There's the old tradition that goes way back into the mists of time and is at its height perhaps in medieval time and then goes downhill from medieval times and comes to a crunch in the 18th and 19th century and just stopped there. It comes to an end. And then at the same time, there was a new tradition, newly invented, picking up on all about romantic symbolism, but doing it in a bit better, modern, improving way, using continental technology and musical ideas to get a new tradition up and running. Well, one of the things that's happened for a long time, I would say, actually, for 100 years or more, is that people have looked at the new tradition and gone, that's lovely, but that's not the ancient tradition. Okay, so people have realized that it's not the ancient tradition. Other people have not realized. There's plenty of people who will try and sell you the new tradition as ancient, timeless, unchanging. That ancient Celtic harp was that whole kind of mythical, timeless thing that we get to some part of traditional music. So there's a big narrative of continuity or unchanging, the very modern improved tradition is timeless and ancient. But there have been people for well over 100 years who have gone, no, that's not right. The old tradition is different. Okay? But the old tradition is dead. So what do you do? Well, you have to get it going again. If you want to get it going again, you have to, you don't want to make things up because that leads you down the route of modern improved tradition. So you can start using archaeological and historical tools to try and get the old tradition working on its own terms. Okay? And so this is a familiar territory in classical music because we have like Arnold Bellmetri and that has worked with before as a lutes and harps of course. These old traditions have basically died out. You have to get them going by taking the original instruments and then definitely like when you study the historical methods and you learn how to play in the old tradition. Yeah? So people have been trying to do that with the harps. And it's much harder because there's no use in music. None of the old harp music was ever written down by the harpist. It was a complete oral tradition. So you can go and you can get a record instrument, but then how do you play it? There's no instruction book, there's no source notation. So this is the work that I'm working in, with my colleagues in Ireland, and we're trying to almost invent ways to understand the old tradition in order to get up and running again. This is what I'll show you in the last few minutes of this lecture. So this is my harp, and I commissioned this from a sculptor over in Ireland. So this is a replica of the medieval harp in the National Museum of Edinburgh. It's the one that's called Queen Mary harp. This is the one that I showed you the cross section of that slide earlier. Okay? And so the idea of this replica is when I commissioned that, I told him we have to do it as exactly as possible, the same as the Modern Museum. No questions, no
deliver the flame, and then I have to work out how to put strings on it. It might be interesting to have to get up and play it. So I learned a lot. I had to play watching myself not to get shortcuts, change it, or to what I thought nowadays would be a good way to do it. I just want to make sure that it's a good point to understand it. I took it across to the hat maker in Ireland and had some work done on it and pulled it to pieces and made it. You can pull the thing up, and nothing's going to stop it. It's out. And then you get a piece of hat out. It's very strange. Okay, and so you can get the instrument working, and there's various, like I said, when we were looking at the scan, there's various physical parameters that give you, like, there's got a certain number of strings or a certain piece of art. There's those wear marks. And the wear maps are very interesting in that they give you quite a lot of specific information about how you have to hold the instrument to match the wear map. Now, one of the ones that I've discovered most recently is when you look at the bottom of the instrument in the museum, there's a big ablation here and here. And I think it's pretty obvious that the instrument was balanced like this. And this is not something that anyone's ever thought of doing with the effect of this. But I can find it now, and I've got my little table to show, so I can't show you it in action today. But things like this, and it's something that gives you a completely different idea, because everybody would think of the harp standing up like this, you'd say, yeah. But there's these ablation marks that clearly shows it would be like this. And this changes your idea. Imagine it sitting on a table like that. But it's with this kind of angle here. Yeah? And then you've got these ablation marks here and here. So obviously you put your hands in it there. And then you're kind of stuck here with the instrument. So now what do I do? And so you see there's all kinds of things going on. So you're holding it quite low, you've got your hands separated out. Your right hand is up here on the bass strings of the harp, and your left hand is there. That's kind of interesting. Reverse of how the piano is. Reverse of how you play all the modern harps, all the modern Scottish Irish harps, all the continental harps, and then the other way around. And that has big implications for how you understand it, really. Because now you're in a position, do you play a tune with your left hand, and a chord with your right hand, or is that just speak? It's not going to do with left handedness and right handedness, it's to do with how you divide the pitches of the instrument between the two. So there are all kinds of studying the historical instruments and work with the record. Okay, the other, so that's one of the most important strands of research for me in terms of getting historical performance practice up and running, is the old instruments. They're such rich resources. And they make up for the lack of written notation, because we've got this selection of 18 old instruments from medieval through to the 18th century that you can study as a body of evidence and understand how the design changes and how the instruments are used. And that's the subject that's only just beginning. There's a huge amount of research ways to be done on the old instruments to tell us practical applications of the instruments. But the other thing we have, is I said that there's no primary musical sources, okay? But there are secondary musical sources. So what happened is the old harpers never wrote their music down, but other people did. And so there's various different types of other material. So the first thing that happens is really good. The harpers were the most high status musicians, and so their music was the most high status. So other musicians took it up in the 17th century. These lute players took harp tunes and played them on the lute and wrote them in their lute books. And so you can start just getting the material back off them. But obviously, as it gets transcribed, it's changed. So there's a lot of reverse engineering to do to understand. So this is some of the latest notations that I've shown you up here.
These were written in the 1790s, 1800s, by Edward Bunting, who was the first proper music collector. He was the first person to ever do kind of field collecting of traditional music. And he went out and sat down beside old musicians and said, "Play it." He scribbled it at full speed, what they were playing. Then later on, he went home and he turned it to carol arrangement. Well, that's what you do. But we have his field notebooks. So you can use these scratchy transcriptions to try and understand what the old guy is doing, how they're playing. And Bunting is very good with all kinds of stuff. So he's scribbling things that they're saying, like alternative titles, which most of what he's got on these sheets.
This is on your handout on the PDF, so if you look at the first one.
But he scribbles all the work. He tells you other things. He writes down the names of every string on the harp and the rules and how it's tuned and all this kind of thing. So there's a lot of really first-hand practical information there. So I'll play you some fragments of this tune. This is one of the most interesting tunes because it was a teaching tune, and so the harp is going to play this tune as a performance piece, but they have it as a tune that you would give students. So I think that's quite old. There's lots of interesting features about this tune. It connects into Scottish bagpipe tradition, it connects into the Gaelic Harp tradition, it connects into other notations from other related musical harp positions. And as I said, it's formed of this section, it's got a little chorus and a geometric variation, and also a chorus and variation. Just to show you how a kind of comparative study of the old repertory works. So for me, this is the primary. It's not primary because it's second hand, but this is the most important musical notation. These fields are by the music collector sitting beside an old harp who's trying to transcribe what they were playing. This is our most direct connection to the music. But there's not much of that. But a lot of the more interesting ancient repertory is not represented in these very late transcriptions. This is just about the only one I would say is a medieval tune of origins, the only one tune like this that's notated in the field by Bunting for the harp, but all the other stuff is like Carol Anne and 1870 songs and that kind of thing. So to get to the older repertory, you have to use the other less satisfactory notations.
But you can do a lot of work by comparing.
So here's our same tune in other older sources, and so you can see this. Again, this is on your handout, so you can work through this in your own time if you want. So what you can do is you can try and find the same tune in different books, in different sources. So these two, the top one is a pipe setting from Irish pipes. Okay? And you can see it's got quite a different tune because it burns mark, a very old tune, and it's in this Irish, rather slowish. But
hidden in this rather florid Irish pouch style setting, you've got that same motif of the little kind of chorus and the repetitive geometrical variation where it goes dum 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 with a kind of framework. It's kind of hidden in there. You see it a bit. And at the bottom we've got Imbo, it's emotional, the titles of it. And it's and this is a vocal setting that was used for the singing of poetry. So the very simple version of it that you would use for the kind of recitative, presenting lots and lots of verses to form a complex poetry. And again, I'm looking for stylistic similarities, stylistic differences.
And on the other side of your PDF,
there's some Scottish sources for the same tune. And again, they're different in every one because of the way that they were collected. So Patrick MacDonald on the left here is collecting vocal airs. It's a combination of Patrick and his brother, Joseph. So they're out in the second half of the 18th century collecting vocal airs in Scotland, and they get two related tunes to ours. None of them have the titles, but I think they're related, especially the second one. And on the right, you've got Daniel Dow, who's a fiddle stuff that he's written collecting. Again, in the middle, second half of the 18th century, in Perthshire. And he calls it Bonnie Peggy, which connects in with one of the titles of the plantation collection that Harry Carpenter. So you know what I mean? It's in some ways it's kind of crazy, it's very unsatisfactory. You've got this wealth of fragments that we put together, various titles that don't quite match. But I hope you can see that by doing this comparative way, you can start this. It's the same as what I said with the old house. You line everything up, and then you start to see where the similarities. Okay? And my idea is that where you see similarities, you're seeing fragments of the old tradition coming down through different cultures. And where you see differences, you can say, well, presumably that's being changed.